How cool does this animated gradient background look? It also scrolls with the position of the content on top of it. So it makes it kind of ideal for a really unique background. There are loads of different color presets, and we can play around with the speed at which it moves. Some other input variables, such as the scale and the number of iterations, just end up with something that looks like a piece of art. I hope you enjoy the video, and if you learn something from this, please give me a thumbs up and consider subscribing so that I can make more of these videos. Peace. All right. So the steps will be as follows: create a full screen shader using a ScreenQuad component, implement a gradient using the cosine color function and the presets from the thin color package. We'll add a Y translation to the fragment shader so that it moves in line with the user's scroll. And this will give it the effect of it kind of like following the content beneath it. We'll add noise and time, which will animate the gradients. And we might review the controls as well. So here in my Next.js page, we've got a client component. If you're doing data fetching or whatever, then keep this as a server page and then move this inside the client component. We've got a canvas imported from React 3 Fiber, just fixed position on the inset zero. Now into the scrolling background gradient component. The Because we're using gsap, we'll need to register the plugins. The uniforms for the shader are a defined type here, and I've created a default color palette, which is then passed into the initial uniforms. The initial uniforms are used to create our custom shader material, which is imported from React 3 Dre, along with the vertex and fragment shaders from the folder. This then needs to be extended so that we can use it as a JSX element here. In order to satisfy TypeScript, the JSX elements, intrinsic elements, are extended here to include our scrolling background gradient material with the correct types. So yeah, as you can see, there are no TypeScript errors, which is nice. The ScreenQuad is imported from React 3 Dre. That's a three vertices mesh, which is ideal for kind of full screen rendering or post-processing effects. Because there's only three vertices, it's more performant. So it makes sense to use that here, as this is just a full screen plane. We've got a ref on our shader with, again, the correct types and a scroll progress ref, along with our custom config. The uniforms are set as defaults here. And in our use frame hook, we are updating the time uniform and the scroll progress uniform. And the scroll progress is set using a gsap scroll trigger, which starts at the top and ends at the bottom of the page. When it updates, we take the progress value, which is between 0 and 1, multiply it by the screens to get a value between 0 and, in this case, 29. Because I've defined the screens as 30 here, and I've set the height of the main element to that. And then -1 because the first screen is already visible. So we're not actually scrolling across that. Yeah, so that basically covers the component setup. It's TypeScript safe with all of our uniforms and elements defined. Quick look at the vertex shader. It's a simplified vertex shader for the screen quad. It doesn't need to process the 3D space, so there's no kind of view position, etc. I can just copy this. In the fragment shader, we have our uniforms at the top, so our time, progress, and the config values, which are passed in. We've got our varying UV from the vertex shader, and then a color palette function. So all of the preset colors in this are taken from this cosine color gradient generator. So you can see them all here. And basically you get this array of vector 3 values. And these are used, these are then passed in here. A, B, C, there's four of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, A, B, C, D. Those are passed in here to return a color. And so when we've got one of these selected, rainbow, here we're just using the Y value, the UV coordinate. So we get a linear gradient along the Y axis. I've imported all those colors into the configuration here. So in the use config, I've imported the gradient presets from here, and then they become the options in the color palette dropdown. And then in order to pass it into the shader, using the palette key, mapping it into a vector 3. So that is that, along with, we've got some other config options here, such as the time multiplier, the scale, iterations, and intensity. So now we've got kind of our basic gradient setup. This looks pretty nice as it is. We can translate, we can update the Y value with our scroll progress. So now this starts to move. Although notice this is no longer yellow and red. And that's because this gradient color is expecting a value between 0 and 1, but now this has been thrown off because scroll progress is between 0 and 29. So we would need to kind of put that in a sine function or do something to clamp it between 0 and 1 if we don't want our colors to be distorted. But for what we're doing here, that we're actually gonna use our noise function, which is imported from GLSL noise. And we can then pass in our adjusted UV value and time, or sine time, either would work. And then we're normalizing that value so that it is in the range of 0 and 1. And I've named this the color input. So now if we use our noise value, we no longer have a kind of linear gradient. We've got something that looks a lot more organic. If I enable the scaling of the UV, see, now we can see the noise function more clearly. It doesn't look so good like that. It's really a lot nicer when it's more subtle like this. And then finally, the distortion iterations and intensity are just been done inside a little for loop here, up to the number of iterations passed in, and then the UV value it's having another noise value added to it, which takes in the UV and the I value, the index from the iteration and time. I'm just fiddling around with values here to get something that would be different for each iteration of the loop. Then finally, that's multiplied by the distortion intensity. So as we increase the intensity, we get a much stronger effect. And obviously, as we add more iterations, again, get something like that. We can see from this outline here, when there's no time multiplier, that this is appearing to scroll nicely with the HTML content. So we could put something on this, and yeah, it would look like it's like a ginormous image or something to the user that's moving behind it. So yeah, I think it looks pretty cool. Feel free to have a play. This is going to be up on my site under the examples. You can access it from the side menu here, and the code is also going to be pushed to the public repo. Hope you found it interesting, and if you've got any ideas for what I should look at next, I'm learning more about shaders each day. Certainly don't consider myself an expert. I feel very much like a beginner, but I'm kind of starting to enjoy this because it seems to me like creating art in a way. Happy coding. Have a good day. Bye.